my passion in life, my scientific passion is in trying to understand whether there are other life forms in the universe besides the ones that we find on Earth. And right now, I'm having my first experience of being involved in a NASA flight mission from the ground up. And I'm leading a science team to, our responsibility is basically to work with the engineers and help to define what the specifications are for this camera that will take the first pictures of planetary systems, whole planetary systems, orbiting stars that are near to the sun. These are all stars that you could see with your naked eye. If you walk outside, they're bright, they're nearby, they're similar to our own. Some of them we know do have planets around them. We know for sure because we've been monitoring them for decades, but there could be more planets in the system that we don't know about because they're below our detection threshold in detecting that motion. And those might pop up in these images, so there's some discovery space there in addition to the ones that we know about. You know, for now, we're just going after the ones that we know about, which are big. They're like Jupiter-sized planets. And it's a big stretch for us to hope that we might find a planet that's more like ours with this particular camera. I mean, it's the first one. We've got to start somewhere. And but this new generation of scientists coming into the picture wants to be involved in bigger missions that will actually be able to find planets that are like our own. And so part of my job in supporting this mission is to work with the wider community of early career people and more mid-career and senior people too, who just want to know how to do this, to fold in all the data, all the observations that we have, whether it's radial velocity measurements going back decades or other kinds of measurements, with these images in order to really pin down and learn as much as we possibly can about these planets. Because this kind of experiment is just incredibly difficult. It's the most high contrast photography you'll ever do. Taking a picture of a tiny little planet right next to a blazing star 10 or 20 light years away. So Carol mentioned the Starshade that I'm also working on. Starshade is, you can think of it as a giant sheet of plastic shaped kind of like a sunflower. It's got a really specific shape that it has to have in order to block out that starlight and basically just aim it away from the telescope so that it casts a really dark shadow over the telescope of starlight, a shadow in that starlight. And then you can just see, you can make out the little planets just off axis to the side of that shadow. Then now all of a sudden this mission becomes much more capable and we would be able to see Earth-like planets around these sun-like stars, which is kind of the holy grail. And again, it would just be the first step in that because ideally we would do this for tens or hundreds of stars in order to have a real hope of finding something super interesting.
This mission that you have coming up where you're going to go with the camera to see the stars, how are you choosing those stars with their planets?
Great question, and actually the most important question that we've been talking about over and over and over and over again for the last few years. We're going to look at the easiest ones. Is basically what it comes down to. Some of these planets are, what we know about them is a rough estimate of how big they are and how close they are to their star, because what the radial velocity data tells us is, one, we can tell how long it takes for the planet to go one time all the way around that star, pulling it back and forth. So we know if it, you know, does it take 1 year or 3 years or what. So that tells us how much of a separation it's going to have from the star. And then we also have an estimate of how massive that planet is. And given that, we can have very, very approximate guesses or somewhat educated guesses at how bright it's going to be and how far away from the star. And we have to dovetail that with the technology that we think we can advance to take those pictures. And so there's kind of a sweet spot of separation between the planet and star, and then the overall size of the planet, bigger ones are brighter, so if that makes it easier. But we have a list of like a couple dozen stars that we hope to be able to get to, but the boots on the ground requirement as far as NASA is concerned is that we directly image, we take a picture of at least one of these planets, and that furthermore we get spectral information out, the colors of the planet out, so that we can start to know things about its atmosphere and actually, you know, study the planet, other than besides just know that it's there.
When you get together at these seminars with all of your other fellow astronomers, scientists, do they talk about there being a possible Area 51 somewhere that collects these types of unknown intelligence?
The thing about Area 51 and have aliens visited us, and I mean, that's actually really illogical. That's a completely rational thing to ask, right? Like, well, maybe actually they have, but we just don't know that. And that is possible. Having witnessed how a mission comes together from the ground up and like what it takes in order to pull something like that off, I don't have like insider knowledge as far as like how our Defense Department works or anything like that. But my sense is that it would be really hard to keep a secret like that, especially with all these scientists running around loose who have to tell everybody everything. I can confidently tell you that in all of my conversations with my colleagues, and including the ones of us that want there to be aliens, and we have nothing like that. We have nothing like that that we could point to and say, oh yeah, they've definitely visited us, but the government is hiding. And scientists have no motivation whatsoever to keep secret anything that they've discovered or learned, especially not when it's something as interesting as aliens. So I cannot say, you know, the government is not hiding anything from us, because I don't have inside access to all that, but I can tell you that if any of us knew about it, you would too.
I just was curious, if everything goes well in 3 years, what's the time frame that we might start getting some data back?
Yeah, so we are supposed to launch in 2025. So far, nothing has gone wrong. So, I mean, other than the other mission that has had its problems, which could then end up impacting our schedule, it could, hopefully not. But if we launch on schedule, 2025, then we, for the exoplanet camera that I'm working on, we have been given 90 days, actually, to demonstrate that it's working. So we will have 3 months of time to use for ourselves. There's another camera on board too, which is actually the bulk of the mission. Ours is the most exciting, but theirs is the most. So that 3 months of time won't happen all at once, but it has to be completed within the first year and a half. So we'll, and then beyond that, whatever time we can have allocated, we'll keep going and keep using. And assuming everything survives and works well, we'll just keep using the camera to do more and more and more planetary systems. And then hopefully a Starshade will arrive like in 2027 or 2028, and then we can do really cool things with our camera. But nominal technology demonstration is within a year and a half with 90 days of observing time.